praise God this morning. He knows what our need is. He's always going to be on time. He's going to answer as only he can. It's going to be a good answer, and we're going to be pleased with it. I know that, as I said last week, sometimes it's hard to have faith for tomorrow based on that, but if we'll look at yesterday and the day before, how he took care of those days, he'll take care of tomorrow as well, and we praise God for it this morning. I hope when you began to sing that song, you said, hey, I still preached on that last week. The lady who was told to go and make a cake for Elijah and give him that cake and drink of water. She said, I only have enough for one meal. And he said, I know, but if you'll do this, God will stretch it out. And he stretched it out by the grace of God. And we praise God for it this morning. We want to continue on that subject this morning. So we're going to ask you to turn with us to 2 Kings chapter number 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. And we'll go through that chapter this morning in our Bible app we want to talk about this morning for just a little while here. 2 Kings chapter 4. We are glad that you're here this morning. We do miss those who are gone. Glad to have Danny Vick with this morning. Pray that God bless them. Gene and Tal, we're glad you're here this morning. Pray that God bless you. Sister Gene, we're glad you're here this morning. Michelle, glad you're here this morning. Pray that God bless both of you and all of you as well. Bill, we're glad you're here. Rachel, glad you're here. Danny, we're glad you're here. Sister Phyllis, we're glad you're here. Andrew, we're glad you're here this morning. Let's remember those who are not here. We do miss Jason and Celeste and Kylie and Jason and Kylie and Elijah as they're traveling. Different direction, but they're traveling. Let's pray that God will be with them. Joel, I don't know where he is, but let's pray that the Lord will be with him this morning. Maria as well. Let's remember Carmen and her pregnancy, and pray that the Lord will be with her and Steve as they're going through this. And I'm thankful this morning that the Lord knows all of them. We don't have to try to remind him who they are. He knows all of them. He knows us as well. We praise God for it this morning. 2 Kings chapter number 4 this morning, and we'll start verse number 1 as we go to this passage of Scripture. 2 Kings chapter 4 verse 1.
Servant, my husband is dead, and thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord, and the creditor has come to take unto him at his feet and bowed herself to the ground and took up her son and went out.
Father, I thank you for this passage of Scripture. Ask the Lord in Jesus' name that you'll teach us those things you want us to know. I pray that you'll allow the Holy Spirit to go out and interpret to each one, each thought of those who are here, the need of their heart today, Lord. I ask that you will meet that, recognizing, Lord, neither can we know nor can we answer those, but you can. We ask, Lord, in Jesus' name that you will. I praise you today for the word of the Lord. Praise you, God, because it is a lamp to our feet, light to our pathway, that when we hide it in our heart, we may not sin against thee. And it sanctifies that, even as your word has told us, Lord, sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. In Jesus' name, help us to walk uprightly, staying in the word of the Lord, even giving day by day our daily bread, receiving it into our heart, that we might not, Lord, sin against you. I pray in Jesus' name that you be with each person who is here today. Encourage them in the name of the Lord by this word. Give them that they have need of. And we pray, Lord, help us to step out of the way that you may do that for a good word. We'll thank you as we ask all these things in Jesus' name, for your honor, Lord, and your glory. Amen. This passage of Scripture this morning, I want to remind you, first of all, we talked about last week, Elijah was the man of God who was in 1 Kings. He was a man of God who did mighty works before the Lord. And the story we told about last week, an actual happening again, not a fairy tale, was when he went to the widow's house that was in Zarephath, Sidon, and the Lord told him that I've prepared someone there to take care of you during this time of drought. Remember, we talked about last week that not only was she there to take care of his need, but he was there to take care of her need. Now, she did not know it at the time, but her need was far greater than his need. He needed food and water. She needed food and water for that day, her last day, but she also needed to have her life, her life and her son's life extended, and then she needed, found out later on she needed, that her son was going to die, and she needed even more than that. I would challenge you to realize that the Word of God teaches us, and one of the things we learn very early on, it will allow the Lord to teach us, is that the things that are most important in this life are not to be had in this life. We can't get them from the people around us. The kingdom of this world cannot share with us the things that we have need of, because they don't have it. We do not live according to the values of this world. If we did, we'd step on anybody we had to. We would back talk and back mouth anybody we needed to at work so we could get the job and they would have it. We would cheat, lie, and steal and everything else. That's not who we are. And because that's not who we are, the fruits of those things that they do in the world around us are not what we're going to get. Nor do we want them. We want integrity of heart so that we're walking honestly and uprightly before the Lord so we can be called his children and receive his favor. Those are eternal blessings, not just things here. They do just take care of the things we have need of here. I praise God who takes care of our needs here. But more importantly, takes care of the things that no one else can take care of. You cannot buy the things that you need eternally. They can't be bought, can't be sold. There are people in this world who are pulling strings, who think that they're in control, and God is saying, I'm in control. He's still working on plan A, what God said in the beginning, he's still doing. He is still allowing things that sometimes we have allowed with a doubt in our mind as to why they're taking place, when quite frankly, we have caused them in our life because of sin. And the Word of God teaches us this morning, that as this passage teaches us as well, when we talked last week, that God is in control, most importantly, of life and death. There are people today on their deathbed who will have no choice about their deathbed. They cannot change that. But Jesus can. There are people who have died, and Jesus can change that. I believe that it happens quite often. We don't hear about it maybe as often as we probably should, but the thing we call miracles happen because the God we serve does those miracles. And the passage of Scripture we talked to you last week about Elijah and the boy who had died and the Lord brought him back to life is a testimony of the Lord Jesus whose desire to give us resurrection and new life in him. This passage of Scripture in the fourth chapter of 2 Kings happens after Elijah has been taken up in a whirlwind, a chariot of fire, to go with the Lord, and his servant Elisha is now the one who is following after and listening to the word of the Lord and is a man of God. In the first three chapters of 2 Kings, we hear about the first two chapters about Elijah and his last miracles, about him going up into heaven. In the third chapter, we hear about Elisha as he begins his ministry. And in the fourth chapter, we hear this very interesting story, again, of two women who had a great need. One of them was a widow, like the one we talked about last week. The other was not a widow, but she had no son. I would challenge you to realize that perhaps the greater need, I hate to say this man, but perhaps the greatest need was the one who had no son, not the one who had a husband. That sounds kind of harsh, but the husband would age and die much quicker than the son would, and if the son were raised right, he would take care of his mother long after the husband was gone. I'm not trying to denigrate husbands. I am one, and so I don't want to say set us aside, but I will tell you this, that in those days especially, the need for having someone to take care of you, if you were a widow woman or if you were a woman in general, was great. It was a great need, because in those days and time, it was not necessarily possible for a woman to just go out and get a job. We can talk about professions in the Bible, and we won't, but I would tell you that in most cases, the professions that are there are not women-oriented. It was man's world that day and time, and unfortunately, as the situation was, it was pretty much if you were a widow, you were on your own. And it's the sad circumstances, we hear the stories this morning, that many times the man of the house, either by neglect or by necessity, it happened too fast for him to do anything about, did not take care of his family so that when he was gone, his family was taken care of. In this passage of scripture that we talk about, the first few verses here, that's exactly what happened. A man of God, who was one of the sons of the prophets, that means God worked with him and worked in his life, and he was a godly man, had a family, two sons and a wife, and when he died, she came to him and said, "You know my husband was a godly man, and he has died, and we have nothing, and he owed a debt." I'll say that the way the Bible says, because debts were made in those days, not necessarily by women, but by men, and the debt was made by the husband, who now is not there to be able to pay the debt, and the scripture says that she said, "Instead of me being able to pay the debt because I don't have anything, this man we owe says, I'll take your two sons as slaves." Imagine how horrible it must have been for her to go through the thought process. Not only have I now lost my husband, but now I'm going to lose my two sons. Not only am I going to be alone, but they're going to be enslaved, and who knows for how long. And so she was in a turmoil. Because she was in a turmoil, she came to Elisha, the man of God, and said, told her story what happened there, and Elisha said, "What have you got in the house?" Let me bring a thought to you this morning. There are times in our lives when what we think we have is very little and unimportant. And you know what? It's never little or unimportant. It has been given by God, and if we can give it over to His purpose. In this passage, we talked about last week, the little that she had was a little bit of meal and a little bit of oil. That's all she had, and then she was going to, her son was going to die. When Elijah said, "Give that to me, make me a cake first, that won't dry out," the scripture says that little that she had lasted for the 3.5 years of the drought, and she and her son and her household, including Elijah, had food and something to eat every single day, drink something every single day during that drought, and that only came by the grace of God, because the little she had in her mind, the little she had perhaps in Elijah's mind, was much. I would challenge you to realize, when we talk about this in a spiritual manner, we might think that, well, you know, I'm not really that important, I'm not really smart enough to do this, or I wish I could do that, I'm not wealthy, I can't do this. Let me challenge you this morning. What you have is all God needs to be able to do mighty works for His word, for His namesake. In this passage of scripture this morning, this woman said in the days of Elisha, "I only have a little bit of oil, that's all that's in the house." And Elisha told the woman, "You go and borrow as many vessels as you can for your friend, pots and pans, as many of them as you can." Now, I'm sure that as she had her sons go out and pick up pots and pans, they were bringing them into the house, she probably was wondering why in the world he told her to do that. She may not have had any spiritual inclination at all of what was going to happen. It's really neat when we read the Bible, because we know what happens. But the people involved didn't know. And she perhaps had no idea what was happening here when Elijah told her to go get pots and pans as many as you can. The scripture says that as her sons went and brought them in, after she brought them in, she went back to the man of God and she said, "That's what I've done." Let me bring a thought to you this morning. It is very important for us to get the complete word of the Lord, even if it takes a time for us to do that. Elisha did not tell her the whole plan when he said, "Have your sons go borrow pots and pans." Elisha didn't tell her what to do after she got the pots and pans. And so she went to Elisha and she said, "What do I do now?" Elisha didn't tell her after the oil was there what to do with the oil until she went back and asked. And I challenge you to realize, sometimes the reason we get ourselves in trouble is because we don't stick with the program long enough and ask for God's direction in every area of our life, and we end up messing up. Much like the song Sister Phyllis just sang, we give up Tuesday when the answer's coming on Wednesday. Isn't it sad to think we're one day short? I guarantee this morning that you have no more patience than I do. We don't have any. We're real bad at it. But I also promise you this morning, if we will be patient with the Lord, we'll find out He's never late. He might be later than we want Him to be, but He's never late. And in this passage of Scripture, the Bible says that as she went and got all the pots and pans that she could find from all her neighbors, brought them into the house, that she told her sons, we'll talk to the man of God, what should we do? And the man of God said, "Close the doors of the house. You and your sons in the house and start pouring the oil that you have, that little bit of oil you have, into those vessels. I would direct your attention to the idea that the scripture says Elisha was very well aware of how doubt works. If you don't know this morning, let me tell you how doubt works. The scripture says, talking of doubt and sin, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. That means if you're full of faith and you have just a little bit of doubt, that little bit of doubt in time will overwhelm your faith if you don't put it aside. Set it aside as soon as you can. One of the things that happens in us is when the Lord tells us he's going to do something, and then the devil says, I don't think he can do that. Are you sure that's what he said? Are you sure that that's what he said? And I challenge you this morning that because we are human, we have a tendency to listen to that when what God says is shut the door on your faith and don't let it in. Don't let that doubt in, because that doubt is going to cause you harm and danger. And as he says in the Word of God, if you'll shut yourself in the Word of the Lord, I'll take care of that. In this passage of Scripture, she went in with her sons. She shut the door. When she shut the door, she said, bring me a pot or a pan. They brought it to her, and she took that little vial of oil that she had, just a little bit left, and she started pouring it in that pot. And lo and behold, I like that term, lo and behold, it filled up that pot. And she said, bring me another one. And they brought her another one, and she filled that one up. Bring me another one. She brought another one, and it filled that one up. Bring me another one. She brought that one up, and it filled it up again. I imagine, and this is an imagination of my own, I'm not sure if the Bible would teach it this way, but I imagine that after a certain length of time, she said, wow, this is a pretty cool pot. This is a pretty cool pot of oil there. And I would challenge you to realize this morning, it had little to do with what she started with, and much to do with how the Lord blessed it. Remind yourself of the scripture where Jesus has 5,000 men, not counting women and children, and we might say conservatively, there could have been 10,000 people there easily with women and children and a man. And the scripture says that Jesus said, what do you have? Let's feed them. What do you have? And they said, we have 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And then they actually added 2 in order to cause doubt, because Jesus had to have and had to face doubt as well. Then they added to that the sentence, but what is that among so many? Jesus said, bring them to. And I would challenge you in that passage of scripture that after the Lord Jesus took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and after he prayed for them, the scripture said he began to break them and give them to his disciples. Now, I've thought about this many times, and we've had many different discussions on how it happened, that perhaps he took the fish in two and handed the 2 pieces and went back to the basket to get the 2nd fish, and when he pulled it out, the 3rd fish appeared. Who knows how it happened? It may have been that he pulled the fish in half and he handed it to them, another half grew out. Who knows that? But I would challenge you to realize, as much as was necessary, fed the 5,000 men with all the women and children, took 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and they took up 12 basketfuls of leftovers. You know what God's telling you? I've got all you need and more. And this passage of scripture where the Bible says he took that little vial of oil and she began pouring in the pots, the scripture says that after she got them all full, she said, bring me another pot. And they said, that's all we have. And the Bible says, and then the oil stayed. That means it quit flowing. Let me challenge you this morning with the scripture and an idea of scripture. The Bible teaches us that in the word of the Lord, olive oil is an anointing of the Spirit, is a type of the anointing of the Spirit of the Lord. The olive was where they got the oil for their lamps. It's where they got the oil to anoint themselves. When David says in one passage of scripture, the 23rd Psalm, thou anointest my head with oil. We think about that. Sometimes we don't realize that not only is he talking about being a king and being anointed to be king, but daily they used oil on their hair to keep the bugs from being in, to keep any diseases from being there, to keep their hair cleaner than it might have been otherwise. Remember, they're living in dusty places. And so oil was very important that day. It wasn't just used for food, it wasn't just used for light, but it was used for many other things. And the scripture says here that that oil flowed as the Lord Jesus, by God's power, allowed that to be anointed, so it continued to flow until all the pots were full. And the scripture says when they got all full, she says, go ask the man of God what we need to do. And she went back and asked the man of God. You see, we sometimes presume on the will of God. And when we do, we cheat us. Because the word of the man of God is very telling. Let me read the verse to you. The verse says, verse number 7, and she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil and pay thy debt. Now, that could have been, in her mind, all she had to do. Go sell the oil, and I get to pay my debt, and I get to start fresh. But the word of the man of God, according to the anointing of God, was even more powerful than that. Because he said, go sell the oil, pay thy debt, and live thou and thy children of the rest. He says, not only do you have enough, and are you going to have enough when you sell the oil to pay the debt you owe, but you're going to be able to live on what's left over, you and your children. That's a mighty blessing of God. What he's saying is, I'm taking care of today, the debt's going to be gone, and I'm taking care of the next day, the next day, the next day, the next day. You're going to be able to live on after you sold the oil, what you sold the oil for. And so the power of the word of the Lord is listening to what God says and allowing him to do good work. There's a passage of scripture in the New Testament where the Bible says that there were people who came to the Lord with leprosy. They came to the Lord and had leprosy, and the scripture says that when they came to him, they said, Lord, we know that you can cleanse us. 10 men. We know that you can cleanse us. And Jesus said, I will cleanse you. Go show yourself to the priest. And the Bible says that they went, and as they went, one of them realized he was clean, and he came back and thanked the Lord Jesus for his cleansing. The Bible says that Jesus said, where are the other 9? Weren't there 10? Only this one, the scripture says he was a Samaritan, which as far as the Jews were concerned was an outcast. This is a Samaritan. Is this one, this alien, the scripture says, the only one that comes back? And the scripture says that he made him every whit whole. You see, it wasn't leprosy alone was gone. He was made every whit whole. What that means is, if he didn't have good eyesight, when Jesus got done, he had good eyesight. If he had a pain in his neck, as well as leprosy, Jesus took care of the pain in the neck. If he had another disease that would have been unknown because of the leprosy, Jesus took care of that. Every whit whole means I have completely cleansed you, and you're fresh and new with a great, great, great body because I just did that for you. I would challenge you to realize that if we don't listen to the Lord completely, we might miss out on the blessing, especially if we're not thankful. The scripture says this man was thankful. As soon as he saw that his leprosy was healed, he came back and thanked the Lord. I would challenge you today that perhaps the greatest need you and I have, listen carefully, perhaps the greatest need you and I have is remembering to thank God for what he has already done. You see, we are looking because we're human. Sad to say, we're always looking at tomorrow and what we need for tomorrow, what we'd like to have for tomorrow, what would be good to have for tomorrow. Andy Sammy said this morning, we're always looking to upgrade and enjoy. We want something better and we want to be able to enjoy it for just a little while and then we want to upgrade it again. We want something better than that, better than that. And I would challenge you to realize this morning that what the Lord is looking for from us is thanksgiving. I will quote the scripture for you. The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Don't concern yourself about tomorrow, the needs for tomorrow, the wants for tomorrow, and the desires for tomorrow, until you realize, maybe I should thank God for what I already have. We say this quite often, and I apologize if you get tired of me saying it, but it's the truth, and sometimes that hurts because it's the truth. We have more in this country, in this congregation, we have more than 95% of the people that are in the world around us. We may not realize that because we do not live in Uganda, where they have little babies whose mothers have abandoned them because they can't take care of them. We don't live in Uganda where they are all trying to live on bread and water for a while because that's all they have. We don't live in Mexico or in Iraq or Iran where Christians are persecuted and they don't have anything. We live in the United States where we've been blessed with much. And I would challenge you to realize this morning, perhaps the greatest need we have is the need to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you. I don't know how many times I've said it, one more time I'm going to say it this morning because it's important we heard. What did you do to make sure you were born in the United States and not in some foreign country? You'll realize very quickly you had nothing to do with it. When you took your first breath, it was by the grace of God, and God provided where you were, who your parents were, and everything else involved in that. If you had bad parents, remind yourself you were born here. If you had a bad life, remind yourself you were born here. And no matter how bad your life was here, I promise you, according to the culture of the day of the world, you are better off here than you would be any place else in the world. And you and I need to learn, as that man who was healed from leprosy, and as this scripture talks about this woman who received her children back to her, at least by identity of not being slaves anymore, received her children back to her, and a future with her sons financially that she did not have before. And I dare say she knew how to say thank you. I challenge you today to realize that we have a lot of things that we see God do for us, and we say thank you because we see what God does for us, and we say thank you. And I would challenge you, you probably have many, many, many more that you don't see that we forget to say thankful for because we don't see them. That's why it's important for us every day to thank God for the day, for the blessings of the day, for the mercy of the day, for all the blessings He's given us, because every day, the scripture says, He blesses us every day with good blessings. He is the Father of lights, and every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights. Obviously, because of the time constraint, we're not going to finish this chapter this morning. We're not going to talk about the next woman in our story of the three we're talking about, but we will tell you this morning, give you a hint of next week, and that is that not only was this woman faithful in her faithfulness before the Lord, she was generous. Not only was she concerned with the man of God and where he was able to stay, she set up a place for him, but she was childless as well. And without desiring, even thinking that she should ask for a child, God gave her a wonderful blessing twice. We'll talk about that next week. I'm going to ask us to come and pass the communion this morning. I thank God this morning for the opportunity of recognizing that by the grace of God, we have this wonderful blessing of reminding ourselves, as the scripture says, that we do this in remembrance of Him. I will remind you that the scripture makes it very plain that Jesus says in the book of Luke, when I come back, will you remember me? Are you going to remember me when I come back? And I would encourage you this morning to recognize that by the grace of the Lord, that remembrance, that memory is something that you and I are involved in keeping alive, keeping awake. If you're like my family, my wife specifically, you will be able to remember birthdays and anniversaries because you put them on a calendar and change the calendar every year. I don't do that. I guess that's my wife's job because she's always done that. But I will tell you this morning that the reason she remembers is because she caused herself to remember because she changed the calendar, the new calendar. She wrote down the new date as the calendar was last year, she wrote down the new calendar. I would encourage you to recognize this morning that when you and I really want to remember something very well, we do something about it. One of the things we do, you and I do especially now, and we become so dependent upon phones and memory of phones, that what we do is we get involved in putting things on our phone to remind us. We have alarms or whatever to remind us that it's important for us to remember this day or remember that day. And I would encourage you to remind you this morning that when we remember Christ, it's because we have chosen to make an effort to remember Jesus Christ. We have chosen to make an effort to say, not only has He saved me, not only by His grace has He given me this wonderful gift of knowing who He is, but by the grace of God, He wants me to be able to remember Him. I would challenge you this morning to realize that that effort is well worth the cost. Imagine Jesus coming back and finding out that you forgot. Brother Koshy was telling me years ago that he had a church that had blessed the ministry in India for quite a few years, and something happened, he didn't know exactly what happened, but after a certain length of time, they didn't even take his call anymore. When he would call to ask, I'm going to be in the United States in September, can I come to the meeting? They wouldn't even take his call. After a while, again, someone else took the call, and they said, I'm sorry, we're not involved in that anymore, and so we don't have the wherewithal to be able to help you with that. And so in essence, what happened, what took place was, they were in a circumstance where they forgot him. It didn't matter why they started in the first place, they just forgot who he was. I would challenge you to remember your dearest friend. I don't know who that might be. Your dearest friend, and the day comes when you realize he or she forgot who you were. Now, you might think that's a hard idea, an impossible thought, but I promise you, it's happened before. There became a rift because of this or that, and now you're not on the list. The way we say it in the world around us is, they're dead to me. As harsh as that is, as hard as that is, how much harder and harsher is it if Jesus comes back and we, by our actions, tell Him, we forgot you, you're dead to me. The passage of Scripture tells us, as our table does, the reason we do this is to remember who He is. And so I'm going to ask you this morning to stand with me in honor of the Lord as we participate in this service. The Scripture says that Jesus said, He took the bread and said, this is My body, which is broken for you. See, Jesus didn't know sin. He didn't need to be broken because He had done sin. He had no need of healing in His own body because He was healed He was the healer. Had no need for that. But he said, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And Father, I thank you so much that you took stripes through the Lord Jesus Christ on your body for our healing. I praise you today, Lord, because I recognize that whether we are talking about something that is huge in our mind, a cancer or an AIDS, or something small but common cold, that by the grace of God, through Jesus Christ and stripes and took, we are healed. I praise you, God, for doctors and for medicine, for surgeons and for surgery. But I'm thankful today that while they treat, Jesus heals. This day, Lord, we accept that healing. By his stripes we are healed. We thank you for it, Lord, and we remember the price that you paid in order for us to have it. In Jesus' name. We take the wafer with you this morning. Paul says, after the same manner also, Jesus took the cup. And after he had supped, he said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. And Father, I thank you today for the perfect, pure, and innocent, guiltless life of the Lord Jesus Christ, who came, shed perfect, pure, innocent blood for those like me who are imperfect, impure, and guilty. I ask, Lord, in Jesus' name, that you help us be reminded this morning that when we take this cup, our sins have been forgiven by the blood of the Lord Jesus and his love in going to the cross for us. Help us, Lord, to never forget the sacrifice that he gave, but to always do this and live our life day to day in remembrance of him. In Jesus' name. You take the cup with me this morning. As we've said many times before, in the world we're now living, there are many people trying to find another way. Jesus says, I am the way. He says, no man comes to the Father except by me. Either he's telling us a lie, or he's sharing with us the fact, the only truth, that the only way to get to God Father is through Jesus Christ. I choose to believe the latter, that he is telling us the only way to the Father is through me. And so, when we think about forgiveness of sins, it isn't by being pure, by doing good works, it's by being washed in the blood. So I'm going to ask you to sing with me the song this morning. First verse and chorus. I have been only by the blood. It's only by the blood. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of bless you. We're glad you're here this morning.